Pittsburgh is the leader in the Big East. They have a two-game lead in the loss column on the entire field, but the Panthers always blue-collar and tough, playing without leading scorer Ashton Gibbs against number 10 Villanova tonight. The Wildcats have four Big East losses if they want to stay in the regular season race. They have to win this game at home tonight. In the pavilion, intimate and intimidating, it will be rocking. College game day ready to roll from Nova.
Welcome to College Game Day, driven by State Farm.
Many of Villanova's big games are played downtown Philadelphia at the Wells Fargo Center, but tonight, in front of 6,500 fans, the pavilion on campus, where the Wildcats haven't lost since 2007. It's a string of 46 consecutive games. Pittsburgh has not won in this building since 1994. Glad to have you with us on College Game Day. Reese Davis, Hubert Davis, Digger Phelps, and Jay Billis. Plenty coming up on Pitt and Villanova, but first, the lone remaining undefeated team in college basketball. Coming into the day, Ohio State taking on Wisconsin. Jared, the lost column of Pittsburgh at this moment. And certainly everybody in the Big East is rooting for Villanova to try to bring Pittsburgh back to the pack a little bit in our game tonight. Tips off at 9 o'clock Eastern time. Panthers without Ashton Gibbs, their leading scorer. He's got a knee problem. Going to miss up to a couple of weeks. He's been out a week. Jay Wright, Villanova with Aaron Andrew.
All right, Reese, thank you. Coach, everybody wants to see how your guys can respond after that loss at Rutgers. What's the number one thing you want to see from them early?
I think I've seen it from them in the last 2 days. I've just seen a great intensity, a great attitude to just go on to the next play the next day. So I think we'll see it as soon as they start the game. I think you'll see confidence, and we'll once you see the confidence, you'll see that they've responded.
What about the status of Corey Stokes with that toe for this game tonight?
You know, the closer we get to game time, the more it's probably looking doubtful. You know, we're just trying anything. He's got serious pain in turf toe, and we're trying all kinds of pads, taping, but it's looking doubtful right now.
Okay, well, thank you so much.
You got it, kid.
All right, Reese, back over to you.
All right, Aaron, one of the veteran leaders of this Villanova team, Corey Stokes. If he can't go tonight, and Ashton Gibbs already out for Pittsburgh, how does this impact Villanova, Jay?
Well, it takes out their best standstill three-point jump shooter. You know, he's a guy that's put up about 2.5 threes per game in Big East play, and it means Malik Waynes is going to have to play more minutes. James Bell's going to have to play more minutes. Dominique Cheek. So then they can't afford to get any of their backcourt guys in foul trouble. So everybody's going to have to step forward and make up for the absence of Corey Stokes.
So Corey Stokes, Jay Wright telling us he's doubtful. Nobody has really been able to figure out Pittsburgh in the Big East, save that loss they had against Notre Dame. Is there a little bit of a blueprint now that Notre Dame showed for the way to handle Pittsburgh, Digger?
I'm sure Jay Wright and the team has looked at what Pittsburgh didn't do to guard Ben Hansborough on the ball screen using Gary McGee as the screener. And as you see right now, Hansborough coming over the top. Look at McGee. He hedges, he waits, he's off balance. So what's Hansborough do? He reads his hands down, he decides to pull back and shoot the three. Makes it. Next time on a ball screen to McGee. Make it set. He looks, he hedges, but now he's flat-footed. So what's Hansborough do? Drive right by. There's no weak side help. And I expect, as you see Hansborough go through this way, Corey Fish will do the same thing tonight for Villanova using a ball screen. Whoever McGee plays, they're going to have him set up right into that situation where he's got to play. Corey Fisher coming off that ball screen, and I really think they can take advantage of that. And that way, even though they don't have the bright balance, Corey Fisher can take this game over and win it, no matter who's playing or who is not playing.
Coach, I really think I agree with you. Defending the pick and roll is going to be huge, because when you look at both teams, Pittsburgh and Villanova, they run a ton of pick and rolls offensively, and they've got guys, Brad Wanamaker of Pittsburgh, that can get the ball into the middle, Malik Waynes, Corey Fisher, guys that can penetrate, distribute, score, get to the free throw line. I really think the team that is able to defend the pick and roll the best, I think is going to win this game, Jay.
You know, I thought one of the blueprints for beating Pittsburgh was used by Tennessee and Bruce Pearl when they played in Pittsburgh earlier this year. They defended ball screens by, you know, I call it downing it. They call it icing it. They keep it to one side. They don't let them come off that blast off that ball screen, they basically force it down and keep it to that side. And I didn't think Pittsburgh adjusted to that very well against Tennessee. I mean, it could be interesting what, you know, what happens in this ball game and how they're going to deal with Pittsburgh's ball screen action, because that's a good way to beat it. You got to keep them out of the middle when you're playing Pittsburgh when they're on offense. Keep them out of the middle.
But the other thing you can do, if you're playing a ball screen, you can step out and have control. You can touch your guy you're defending and force what? The guard, Corey Fisher, or Ben's Hansborough, go over the top so that Hansborough or Corey Fisher's defender can slide over the top. You don't have to worry about it because he's got to go on an angle of the arc dribble, and now you recover defensively, and then you slide back and play the post player.
I think the difficult thing playing Villanova, you know, if you want to switch all ball screens and pick and rolls, I don't think that's the answer. But if you trap and take the ball out of, say, Corey Fisher's hand, for Villanova, they have two guys that can penetrate with Malik Wayne. When you talked about Notre Dame, Ben Hansborough was the only guy. Villanova, they have two guys that get to the free throw line, can get to the rim, and can score against anybody.
Well, if they use Gary McGee, they're not going to switch anymore. Yeah. They're not going to switch that. They might go third man under, but if they involve him in ball screen, switching is not going to work.
And one thing that Gary McGee is going to be called on to do, as you guys have pointed out earlier in the day, offensive rebounds is how Pittsburgh is compensated for the loss of some of the three-point shooting, for the absence of Ashton Gibbs. Pitt and Villanova coming up in just a little while. Still to come on College Game Day. Kentucky going on the road. The Cats have had trouble away from home, and they ran into one of the finest shooters in college basketball. Where do you see what John Jenkins did against John Calipari and the Cats? And we'll also check in with Kansas and Texas. Did either stake a strong claim to be the new number one, with Ohio State falling today? We'll show you what both of them were able to do, and we'll bring you back here to the Pavilion. One of the great settings in college basketball, Nova and Pittsburgh.
The games they should have.
Hard-nosed, tough-minded Pittsburgh comes into Villanova tonight trying to maintain their two-game edge in the loss column in the Big East race. Pitt and Villanova get their moves on, ready to go. Xavier Silas and Northern Illinois both having big days. Now, here at the Pavilion on campus at Villanova, they welcome the team coming right through the student section and flashing the V for Villanova. And one thing, this is a small campus. It's an intimate setting. The players know their classmates and vice versa. A great reaction here. They're anticipating the arrival of a Villanova team that you believe perhaps could make a Final Four run when the tournament comes around.
That's true. Everything is up for grabs. You know, we talked earlier, maybe there's four teams that are number one seeds. There's about another 25 that are as good as anybody. And the Wildcats of Villanova know how good they can be, especially with the guard player, Corey Fisher.
This is an old school feel, Hubert. It's a small place, 6,500 people capacity. It'll be packed to the rafters tonight.
Well, I love this atmosphere. The fans are right on top of you. Having the two best teams in the Big East play here in the Pavilion, it's exactly how we want it.
We used to do this for UCLA home games. Let the team go down through the student section. And they know tonight how big this game is. Playing it here, not in downtown Philly, but playing it here to let the students know, hey, we need you tonight to be the sixth man. You give us 40 minutes, we'll give you 40 minutes. Villanova coming off that tough loss at Rutgers the other night, that four-point play at the buzzer. They know what's at stake. Pittsburgh, as good as they are, I still think Villanova knows, with the energy of the student body in this atmosphere, they get it done.
And here come the Wildcats, right down through the students. It has been a tremendous game day experience at the Pavilion, one embraced by the student body and the players who were part of the entire show this morning. Jay Wright came out and told all of the students who packed the Pavilion this morning that Pittsburgh was going to have to play against the team and the entire arena tonight, and that's what the Panthers are ready to do. They lead the Big East, Jamie Dixon with Aaron Andrews not long ago.
All right, Reese, thanks so much. Well, Coach, being here at the Pavilion, obviously, Villanova's got a 46-game win streak. Not the easiest place to play. What's your message to your guys before they head out to the court about that?
Well, just playing our game. I don't think anything changes. We played in a lot of good places, tough places to play. We just played at West Virginia. We just played at Rutgers. So I don't think it'd be any louder in those places. So I think we're used to it. It's part of the Big East, and guys are looking forward to it.
Villanova known for their backcourt. You guys are as well, but, of course, you're without Ashton Gibbs. What do you stress to your guys about playing there?
Again, just doing what we do. And again, we're without Ashton, but it doesn't mean we have to change our game. Doesn't mean we have to take more shots. More guys got to look to do other things. Just play how we play. They've got guards that go off penetration, but we've seen some of that in this league too as well. So keep them in front, make them take tough shots, and then beat them on the boards.
Thanks so much for your time. All right, Reese, back over to you.
Well, Aaron, what Jamie Dixon said, beat them on the boards, the subject of our IBM Insight Center. Pittsburgh pretty much beats everybody on the boards. These two teams are the top two in rebound margin in the Big East, but the Panthers lead the nation. Villanova out-rebounding their opponents by nearly six per game. That's respectable. Pittsburgh's is dominant, averaging more than 12 and a half more boards than their opponents, especially with the Panthers being without Gibbs, taking fewer threes, only made one against West Virginia. Offensive rebounds will be huge tonight.
Yeah, that's the one thing they have from the South. They had 18 offensive rebounds for 16 points. But more importantly, they shot 61% in that second half at West Virginia the other night. Villanova's not going to let that do them. They had that five-point win on the road. But more importantly, I think this is a night. Corey Fisher knows what's at stake, Hubert. I think they're going to take care of their offense, take care of defense, but emphasize five guys boxing out five on five so Pitt doesn't get those second chance points.
All right, we are just a couple of minutes away from tip-off now in this Big East showdown. Time to make our Saturday night selection for the primetime game. Heated atmosphere. Pittsburgh hasn't won here since 1994. 46 in a row for Nova. Who wins it?
I like Villanova, and I think those big guys are going to show up for them. Muhtar Yara, Antonio Pena, Maurice Sutton, Isaiah Armwood. I think they'll do a great job rebounding the basketball, keeping Pittsburgh off the offensive rebound. They'll be able to defend and score around the basket, Coach.
I think that bitter defeat the other night at Rutgers, that four-point loss is still in their mindset. They're not coming home to lose to the sixth man of what this place is playing out here on campus. They will get it done. Corey Fisher leads the attack. Villanova wins this game tonight.
Glad to call.
Reed, thank you very much. And as you said, this is a very unique atmosphere here. The pavilion, the home court on campus of the Villanova Wildcats, as we welcome you to the Infinity College Basketball Tip-Off, bringing you the inspired performances that define the season. And we're expecting some inspiring basketball here tonight. This is a part of Rivalry Week, and this is going to be a good one. Number four, Pitt. Number 10, Villanova, with Pittsburgh right now in control in the Big East Conference, as we show you the top eight of the 16-team Big East. And Notre Dame playing so well. They won again today, one down in South Florida. But Pittsburgh at 10-1. They've got a nice cushion right now on the rest of the league. If Villanova has any hopes of competing for a Big East regular season championship, they've got to win tonight. Hi, everybody, and welcome to the campus of Villanova. Dan Shulman and Jay Billis. The two top shooters are not going to play in this game. Is it going to come down to toughness in this game?
Yeah, if you want to play pretty, this isn't the game for you. I think it's going to be about keeping Villanova, keeping Pittsburgh out of the lane and keeping them off the glass. And Pittsburgh is going to want to dominate the glass. That's what they do. Every shot that goes up, their body's flying. Pittsburgh does a great job of staying in front. They stand you up on your cuts. Everything is physical. I think this will be the most severe physical challenge that Villanova has had all season long.
And we do have, even with the injuries, each team's got one, we do have some very talented guards in this game as we take you now to the Star Watch, beginning with as versatile a guard maybe as there is in the country.
Yeah, Brad Wanamaker, five assists, five rebounds per game to go along with his 12 points. He is the best player that Pittsburgh has. Ashton Gibbs, the best scorer, who's out. And on the other side, Corey Fisher, an outstanding guard, 16 points, five assists per game. He is dynamic off of ball screens, and he has shot the ball extraordinarily well over his last 10 games.
A great atmosphere here tonight, just about ready for tip-off. But first, let's go to Aaron Andrews.
Well, Dan, some breaking news for Villanova. They will be without their starting guard, Corey Stokes. He's out with turf toe. He was just watching his team warm up a few minutes ago with a boot on his left foot. I talked to Jay Wright before the game. He said that's the same turf toe that kept him out of the second half in that Rutgers game on Wednesday night. It was just too painful for him to go tonight. They tried, you know, putting a steel plate in his sneakers. It wasn't working. He was trying to warm up, and it just wasn't happening. Malik Wainstein will take his spot in the starting lineup.
All right, Aaron, thank you. So each team is without arguably its best shooter. We'll see how that plays out over the course of the night. Thanks for watching the Infinity College Basketball Tip-Off as tonight's coaches bring the essence of the fans into their game.
I think the players inspire me, and I hope that we as coaches inspire the players. Pitt fans are passionate, loyal.
anybody that comes in to play Villanova has got to not just play our 13 guys, but they're playing the entire student body. You feel the power from the crowd. It keeps you fired up, whether you're up or down.
Infinity is an official corporate partner of NCAA men's basketball. Spread some inspiration of your own at ESPN.com/Infinity.
And welcome to Saturday Night Primetime, presented by DirecTV. This is all a part of Rivalry Week, presented by Cisco. And this is a rivalry. The Pitt Panthers, the Villanova Wildcats, they know each other. A lot of them were recruited by both schools. Oh, and they're two of the top 10 teams in the country and two of the top teams in the country's best league, the Big East. This should be a lot of fun here at the quaint, cozy pavilion on the campus of Villanova University. The starting lineup beginning with Pittsburgh. Trayvon Woodall filling it at the point for the injured Ashton Gibbs. He'll be joined by Brad Wanamaker with the backcourt. Gilbert Brown, Nasir Robertson, and the big man in the middle, a terrific rebounder, Gary McGee. For Villanova, Malik Waynes goes back into the starting lineup because of the injury to Corey Stokes. He'll be joined by one of the best guards in the Big East, Corey Fisher, Isaiah Armwood, Antonio Pena, and Muftau Yaru, the front line that's going to have their hands full with the rebounding and the toughness of the Pittsburgh front line. This is the 61st meeting all time between Pittsburgh and Villanova in what has been a very close series, with Villanova holding a slim edge. And it's not often that a fourth-ranked team of the country, Jay, comes to this building. Usually three or four games a year, Villanova plays downtown. But they're playing a quality opponent in this building. They've won 46 games in a row in this building. But obviously, with the caliber of Pittsburgh, that's at risk here tonight.
Well, this is a bandbox type of arena. It's really a gym, and it can be very tight. It's going to get hot in here. This is a great venue for Villanova to play a top five team.
And as Jamie Dixon told our Aaron Andrews, they've played in a lot of tough places. They just came back from West Virginia, which is no day at the beach, and they picked up a tough win on a Monday night. They are used to getting everybody's best shot. They were the preseason pick to win the Big East. Villanova was picked second preseason in the Big East, and we're underway with the Wildcats in a home right, getting the first possession of the game.
And Pittsburgh starts, as they almost always do, in man-to-man. They will let you make passes on the perimeter, but anything penetrating is going to be contested. You'll be bumped. They are very, very physical.
Fisher so tough off the bounce. He can also shoot it and nails the three. Unfortunately for him this week, the replay we all saw was the foul at the end of the Rutgers game that led to the Rutgers win. By the way, Fisher had 23 points and 10 assists in that game.
And five steals.
Yeah,
magnificent.
Wanamaker at the other end, and we've just seen in the first 40 seconds of the game how great job on the star watch, by the way. You nailed it. You nailed it with those two guys.
Well, I'll tell you what. I think Grant Wanamaker is the best player on this Pittsburgh team, certainly the best all-around player. He's not the best scorer. That's Ashton Gibbs, but he's the best player.
Payne has been working on that jump shot, improving his range. Gary McGee rips it down. He's better than 8 rebounds a game, and the biggest reason why Pittsburgh is one of the best rebounding teams in the country. And Wanamaker, another uncontested jumper.
Well, in transition, Isaiah Armwood didn't get up on Brad Wanamaker, and Wanamaker very calmly pulled the trigger. Nothing bothers that kid. He is unflappable.
And he can play the one, he can play the two, he can play the three. He does so many different things for Pitt.
And he can guard all those positions as well. Now he's guarding Malik Waynes, and that's like trying to guard a bowling ball.
A high school teammate, by the way. They spent 2 years together playing at Roman Catholic High School in Philadelphia. Jay Wright's team 19-5 on the season. He's taken them to a Final Four. He's won better than two-thirds of his games here at Villanova.
We've got two of the finest young coaches in basketball in this ballgame. People ask, well, where are the next great coaches coming from? Who's going to replace Coach K and Roy Williams and Jim Calhoun? These two are.
An early sub for Villanova. Freshman James Bell has come into the game. Number 32 taking Armwood's place. McGee, another rebound. Well, McGee has just improved by leaps and bounds over the last 4 years.
Woodall, a little strong on the three, gets it right back.
Well, what terrific defense on the other end by Nasir Robinson.
Wanamaker. So we've seen the shot. Now we've seen the drive.
And the drive has been too easy. Villanova wanted to protect the paint, keep him out of the middle, take Wanamaker out of the game, take away his left hand. They haven't done that early.
An early timeout for Jay Wright with Wanamaker and Pitt off to a good start. Well, Jay Wright said that Pittsburgh's going to have to come in here and not only play against the Wildcats, but play against 6,500 strong. So far, that does not seem to be facing the Panthers, who are unbeaten, by the way, on the road this year, Jay. But this is quite a unique environment. You've done a lot of games in this building in your travels through the Big East over the years. This is a tough place to play.
Well, the thing that makes it toughest, the crowd is great. It can get a little hot in here, but the Villanova team makes it tough.
Villanova without Corey Stokes, Pittsburgh without Ashton Gibbs, both out with injuries.
Garrett McGee does such a good job defending the post. He just would not let that ball come in to Mutau Yaru.
Pena turns it over to Gilbert Brown. All 6 points for Pittsburgh in the early going belong to Brad Wanamaker, number 22. How about Woodall taking the place of Gibbs? What a job he did.
Well, he's done it before. He did it in high school. Played at St. Anthony's, played behind Tyshawn Taylor and Mike Rosario. And Pittsburgh is just having its way with Villanova early on in this ballgame.
If you break down some offensive stats in terms of efficiency, points per possession, percentage of field goals that come with an assist, Jay, Pittsburgh is right near the top in the country in almost every category.
No question. They do it on the offensive glass. They get good shots. And they have done it without Ashton Gibbs the last couple games.
Big bucket on the inside for Mutau Yaru, 6'10" sophomore from Benin in West Africa.
Stayed low, did not lift up. That's a move that last year he could not have made.
Brown again.
Needed to step up there. Yaru just backed off. That was too easy an opportunity off the ball screen.
Fisher steps in, puts it up, and banks it home. Nicely done.
What a great shot fake by Corey Fisher. He stayed down, but the ball went up, and that caused the defender to lift up.
And a good start for Fisher to bring Villanova back within one.
A good extra pass there off the double team on the other side.
Woodall misses the corner three, and it's Villanova ball.
Watch Corey Fisher here. He stays down on this ball fake. And as a result, see, he catches it here. He stays down. The ball goes up, and then Trayvon Woodall leaves the floor and allows that drive and puts Pittsburgh in a help situation. That's a big-time ball fake by Corey Fisher.
And how many years have we seen just such high-quality guards playing for Jay Wright? One of them is in the house tonight, Randy Foy, now with the LA Clippers, who had his number retired during game day this morning.
Boy, what a terrific player Randy Foy was and still is. But these guards here at Villanova have a lot of freedom. They have a lot of freedom to make plays. Jay Wright puts a lot of trust in guys like Malik Waynes, Corey Fisher, and Corey Stokes. And you can see why.
Waynes rewarding that trust, knocking down the jumper off the dribble, and the Wildcats take the lead.
Villanova much more aggressive the last couple of possessions, looking to put the ball on the deck.
A lot of ball movement offensively from Pittsburgh. Everybody gets a touch. Woodall coming off the screen and banks it home just over the outstretched arm of Yaru.
Just a little miscommunication by Villanova. They called the switch, but called the switch a little bit too late. And Pittsburgh will let you make passes around the horn. You can move the ball from side to side. It's the penetrating moves and penetrating passes that are much more difficult. Terrific help by Woodall.
Armwood back into the game. Finds Giroux, who gives it back to him. Still plenty of time to shoot. Waynes for three. And it's Pittsburgh ball when we come back. A good, intense start, as expected, here in this battle between the Panthers and the Wildcats. Malik Waynes back into the starting lineup tonight because of the Stokes injury. And we've got a one-point game at the Pavilion.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by DirecTV. Don't just watch TV, DirecTV. And in part by Infiniti, luxury cars that deliver inspired performance.
Welcome back to Villanova. We've got a one-point game. Pittsburgh up early on the Wildcats here on Saturday Primetime, presented by DirecTV. More great basketball action coming your way. It's Big Monday, presented by Bud Light, a part of Rivalry Week, presented by Cisco on ESPN, the home court of college hoops. And it begins at 7 Eastern time. Jay will be there as West Virginia's up at the Carrier Dome to take on Syracuse, coming off a tough loss against Louisville today. And then Kansas and Kansas State at 9 o'clock Eastern, all a part of Rivalry Week, presented by Cisco. And what's the difference between Syracuse now and Syracuse 3-4 weeks ago?
Well, they're still playing the same defense schematically, but they're not playing the same brand of defense without Orenze Anawaku and Wesley Johnson and Andy Routens in that defense. Their defense has not been up to the Syracuse standard over the last 7 games.
Remember, it was the game at Pittsburgh where Pitt scored the first 19 points of the game, really picked apart the defense, and Syracuse made a run, but the Panthers held on to win. Waynes in transition, and he's fouled.
It's so tough to stay in front of Malik Waynes. He is so quick and strong. It's not Trayvon Woodall's not quick. He's very quick as well. You can play really good defense and still have Malik Waynes blow by you.
Ashton Gibbs, terrific player for Pittsburgh. Averaging better than 16 points per game, 46% from three-point range. He's got a knee problem out, probably another week or so. Corey Stokes, the best outside shooter that Villanova has turf toe. He was a game-time decision, as Aaron told you, to scratch just before the game. So we'll probably see a little bit less outside shooting, although both teams still have some other good shooters.
Well, that makes keeping each team out of the paint off the dribble vital.
Only four guys in early on that free throw. Let's see who went in first, and it looks like it's going to be Pittsburgh ball for it. Jamie Dixon saying everybody was in. So it's a do-over and a fresh chance here for Waynes.
This is one area where Villanova really excels, knocking down free throws. And when they miss, they certainly don't want to be in early, give them another chance, because they're not going to miss the second time.
They're the best in the Big East, over 77% as a team. Remarkable in this day and age, Jay, when even so many good teams are shooting down in the 60s.
The 1-2-2 three-quarter court pressure right here by Villanova. Armwood up top, that gives a little more length to take away vision.
And Dominic Cheek is the two guard, so this is a bigger lineup right now for Villanova with more length to it.
Cheek, a good defender, but when he guards smaller players, he has to give them a little bit more space.
Robinson, an undersized power forward, but what he lacks in size, he more than makes up for in skill.
Well, he's a winner. Nasir Robinson was terrific at West Virginia. Had 15 points. That led Pittsburgh, had 8 rebounds as well. And in the first game without Ashton Gibbs, to perform as well as they did in the second half. Very impressive.
Cheek wide open off the screen. He misses the three. And look at Robinson sky for that rebound. Pittsburgh out rebounding the opposition by better than 12 per game. The best mark in the country. Loose ball bounces back to the Panthers.
Cheek needed to dive on that. You can't hope to pick that up and take it the other way. You got to dive on that.
And that's going to be a held ball. And on the arrow, it will stay at this end of the floor. Jamie Dixon's upset again. Thought that should have been a foul call. Now Jay Wright goes back to his bench and goes to his more traditional guard lineup with Waynes and Fisher in there together.
Pittsburgh does such a good job of executing out-of-bounds underplays, and Villanova did not guard that particularly well and then foul a jump shooter.
On a three-point attempt, sending J.J. Moore, freshman from Brentwood, New York, to the line for 3 free throws.
This young man is going to be a very, very good player. An outstanding athlete. He could shoot at the three-point, as you just saw. He got fouled.
Jay, that foul was on Fisher, the same guy who fouled against Rutgers in the last seconds of the game on a three-point attempt that eventually cost them the game.
Yeah, this was a different kind of foul. I thought he was in good position against Rutgers on that last play on Mitchell. And he just had his hand in the wrong spot and caught him on the elbow. But there were so many things that went wrong last 4 minutes for Villanova. If they just pass and catch, if they just make a free throw, if they just execute a little bit better on when they had the ball offensively, I mean, you can't expect on the road to shut a team down when they're making a run. What you have to do oftentimes is run good offense to make sure that at least you trade baskets in a tough environment.
Two out of three for Moore and a three-point lead for Pittsburgh. Waynes with a nice stop and go. Beautiful pass inside, and Armwood is fouled from behind.
How about that hesitation move? They went five out, took everybody out of the post, and extended the Pittsburgh defense. And boy, Malik Waynes, that little head and shoulder fake got him right into the lane, put Pittsburgh into help. How do you guard that? Dante Taylor having to help up, and anytime you're helping uphill, you're leaving some room for a drop-off.
Armwood at the line, and this is the first. He has moved into the starting lineup. Jay Wright wants him in there, a little more size, defense, rebound, and you can see the numbers are not big. But it's some of the intangibles and blue-collar stuff that Jay Wright wants from Armwood. Armwood now will go out, and Yeru comes back.
Well, you'll remember last year, Armwood was a freshman early on in the season. He had a game-winning three-pointer to beat George Mason.
Student section trying to rattle Pittsburgh a little bit.
Three-quarter court pressure again with Pena up top.
And the foul on Bell. He's a freshman. Played 7 minutes against Rutgers earlier in the week and scored 7 points. And he really hadn't been playing much at all. But it looks like Jay Wright is starting to move him into the rotation a little bit more, especially with Stokes on.
Well, they need to get good minutes out of him tonight. Bell is going to be another young man who's got terrific potential. Big, strong, very athletic, can shoot it from the perimeter and get to the rim.
6'5", 225. Jamie Dixon brings Trayvon Woodall back in. Both coaches are substituting freely right now. Almost every whistle brings a change from one team or the other.
Pittsburgh has more depth. They're used to playing 10, 11 guys. Not as much depth for Villanova, but they're going to have to go to their bench without Stokes.
Moore with a real height advantage on Waynes. Tough fadeaway baseline jumper, and skying for the rebound is Bell.
They went after that with both hands. That was a terrific rebound.
Yeru, the big guy number 13, was part of last season with hepatitis B and only really got back into playing shape late in the year, but I think he's got a lot of upside.
He could really get a defender moving, Corey Fisher, with all of his ball fakes.
Yeru first was looking for somebody to pass to and eventually decided to look for his own offense, and he turned it over.
Well, at first he showed very good patience, waiting for space to clear, finding out exactly whether guys were going to come to double, if he had any cutters. And then he made his move, just didn't make it strong enough.
Gilbert Brown back in. Minutes in, we've had a total of only three turnovers in the game. Pittsburgh leading Villanova 14-12. Zone look now from the Wildcats.
A 2-3 look matching up.
And an air ball from the corner from Lamar Patterson, and a travel will give it back to Villanova. So the Wildcats throwing some different looks at Jamie Dixon's Panthers right now. Pitt still leading by two. So there will be no unbeaten team here this season as Ohio State does what a lot of teams do, go up to Madison and lose. As we take a look now with a big picture around today's college basketball action, brought to you by Sony. Jordan Taylor with 27 points to lead the Badgers in their win over the Buckeyes. Kansas and Texas both win, although Baylor made a run at Texas in the second half. Who will be the new number one? And Louisville defeats Syracuse as the Orange lose for the sixth time in their last eight games. Who should be number one this week?
Yeah, you can make a great case for Ohio State staying there, for Texas moving up, even though Texas has three losses. I would put Kansas there. I think when healthy, and Kansas is not healthy right now with Josh Selby being out and also with Thomas Robinson injured, but I think Kansas is the best team when healthy.
Pena open and knocks down the long two, the assist to Fisher to tie the game.
Well, Fisher did such a good job of getting into the lane. He didn't panic when he got it there. And boy, he stays low and found Antonio Pena stepping into a shot. And Pena, for a big, is a really good shooter.
Gilbert Brown with the ball. Just into too much traffic. Turns it over.
And that time, Villanova got on the floor for that loose ball.
Waynes to Pena. Count it!
That's more like Villanova basketball under Jay Wright. Getting down on the floor for a loose ball and running the lanes. And Dante Taylor just a little bit there late getting there to try to take that charge. That's solid by Pena. He saw the contact there, was able to just skirt it a bit and still finish the play. He kept his eyes up. And your eyes make layups.
One of three players on this Villanova roster who has scored 1,000 or more points in their careers. And they're experienced, they're talented, and solid is a great word. That's exactly the word that Jay Wright uses to describe Pena.
Well, he's got 1,000 points in his career, also 700 rebounds. Here's that 2-3 zone. A good ball screen.
Woodall using the screen from Talib Zana. Misses the shot. McGee has it.
And nobody's getting that from him.
Nice pass. Zana, no. And now it's Villanova ball. Boy, two pretty good looks on the inside for Pittsburgh.
A good outlet pass. Good pass.
Yeru inside, and McGee stuffs him.
Tell you what, Gary McGee, one of the best post defenders in the country, uses his body well, doesn't allow you to get usually deep post position. He allowed it there, but just stayed strong and made Yeru make a play over him, and he couldn't do it.
Three rattles out. Yeru with great hustle to run down that rebound. Mukhtar Yeru giving Villanova another opportunity as Jay Wright sends him the play for the bench. Wayne's the pull-up.
Villanova does a nice job of keeping their big man behind the defense. They keep him on the short corner where they can get a drop-off off penetration.
And a Villanova foul.
That's his second.
The second on Corey Fisher. Jay Wright not pleased as we check in with Aaron Anders.
Well, he's not pleased right there, but just a few minutes ago when you guys saw the Villanova players hustling, diving, he turned around to his bench and started stressing. See what they're doing? They're diving. They're going after the ball. That's what you need to do when you get in there.
And it's amazing, Jay. It's something every coach wants, but it's something every coach seems to need to reinforce from time to time because it's not a consistent thing.
Well, it's not. Guys aren't born diving on the floor for loose balls. It's just not in people. You have to condition yourself to do that. And Aaron's right. I mean, Jay Wright saw them bend over at the waist for that first loose ball. They didn't get it. The second loose ball, they dove on it, and they got a bucket because of it.
Meanwhile, that second foul sent Fisher to the bench, and with Stokes injured, the depth of Villanova is going to be tested right now. Cheek is going to get some big minutes, and as you mentioned, Bell is going to be very important tonight as well.
Well, Dominique Cheek was a McDonald's All-American, and he's coming along. He is going to be a good player, and they need him to be a really good player next year. But they need him to step forward in this ball game as well.
We also see for the first time 6'11", redshirt sophomore Maurice Sutton out of Largo, Maryland, number 25 for Villanova.
Well, Sutton, not an offensive player, nor is Armwood. So Malik Waynes, Cheek, and Pena especially going to have to do a good job.
Pena got fouled.
Should have shot him.
Yeah, you're right. And he knows it right now. He would have gotten a couple of shots. The foul on Gilbert Brown.
That's his first. Villanova setting ball screens with the guy that's being guarded by Gary McGee. They want to involve Gary McGee in as many ball screens as they can. If you remember late in the Notre Dame game at Pittsburgh where the Irish went to that burn offense, they used ball screens late, and Ben Hansbrough scored time after time after time, and it was usually Gary McGee that was having to guard those ball screens. Switched off, and they were able to really take advantage of them.
It's Pena to set the screen now.
A hard hedge out to a third man under.
Waynes took the bump, kicks it out. And it's Pittsburgh ball.
There is some board crashing going on in this game.
And Pittsburgh up in the rebounding department, as you would expect, with them having the best rebounding numbers in the country so far this season. If Villanova can rebound them to a standstill, that's got to be a win for the Wildcats.
Well, this zone will help Villanova stay out of foul trouble. They can't reach. They certainly can't allow penetration.
Woodall trapped. Almost turned it over. Now it is a turnover. And a block to call on Woodall. And Malik Waynes, Jay, is doing just a great job of initiating and seeking out the contact.
Well, that's what he does. When he goes to the basket, even though he's not a big guard, he just launches himself right into the body of the defender. He draws that contact, and then he's strong enough to bounce off and still finish the play.
As you said, trying to guard him is like trying to guard a bowling ball.
Bowling ball with a head on it. That's kind of what I used to say about Randy Foy. You know, Randy Foy was built like a fire hydrant. They used to call him a fire hydrant with a head on it.
Woodall's gone to the bench after his second foul. So right now, Wanamaker is defending Waynes. And again, these guys were high school teammates. Waynes for three, wide left, rebound Panthers.
I think Waynes needs to drive hard off that ball screen. They are going third man under. He needs to turn that corner and get to the rim.
Nice little entry feed. Robinson way short on the jump hook.
Well, Villanova's long. Armwood's got long arms. Pena's got long arms. Cheek's got long arms. They can bobble you.
Bell, quick trigger, misses the three. Armwood keeping it alive, but then eventually getting called for the foul. And a timeout on the floor. Not a lot of scoring in the last few minutes. Villanova leading by three. Jay mentioned Randy Foy had his number retired earlier today. And here in the house watching his Wildcats tonight. Leading Pittsburgh by three, 7:51 to go here in the first half. At the pavilion, former Villanova guard Randy Foy, who helped the Wildcats reach the Sweet 16 and then the Elite Eight in his final two seasons, had his jersey number two retired this morning during game day here at the pavilion. He was Big East Player of the Year and a consensus All-American in his senior season and finished his career with almost 2,000 points, ninth on Villanova's all-time list. Eventually drafted seventh overall in the 2006 draft. He now plays for the LA Clippers. Must have been a nice moment here this morning.
It was great. And he is such a dynamic player when he was here. Played with Alan Ray and Mike Nardi. And Randy Foy, when he got to the rim, he might have been small, but he got up there and finished and could shoot it. Really tough to guard. And you can see without Ashton Gibbs, this zone effective. Not shooters to go over the top of this zone. They've got to get in the middle of it, and they certainly have to offensive rebound against it.
And again, we saw Pittsburgh have a lot of success against the Syracuse zone a few weeks back. That was pretty nicely done as Gary McGee gets the high percentage look.
Well, Gary McGee was standing behind the zone. He stayed behind it down in the short corner. When the penetration came, help comes up. Yaru comes up. Armwood comes up. Nobody's got vision of Gary McGee. That's pretty emphatic, wouldn't you say?
Those first points of the night. You know, he's like so many other Pittsburgh players, Jay, in that they improve so much from their freshman years to their senior years. Pittsburgh seems to have the Big East most improved player more than all the other schools put together. And McGee spent a couple of years trading elbows and banging bodies with DeJuan Blair, and that has served him well.
And just quietly getting better. You know, serving an apprenticeship, if you will, and the success this program has experienced win-wise over the last 10 years has been remarkable. Yet, they haven't had a first-round draft pick. So they have done it sort of the farm system way of raising their own.
And Bell called for the offensive foul. They're not a single first-round pick into the NBA while Jamie Dixon has been the coach. Only one McDonald's All-American, and that's Dante Taylor, who comes off the bench. But they're tough, blue-collar kids, kind of reflecting the personality of the city, although very few of them come from the Pittsburgh area. Really, DeJuan Blair was the one. But they just get better and better, and year after year, it seems Pittsburgh always has two or three guys who are seniors, and it feels like they've been there forever.
Neither team, back to man-to-man right now for Villanova, neither team has been able to knock down a perimeter shot.
Nice look inside, but McGee couldn't corral the pass. Here's what Jay was talking about, the success that Pittsburgh has had without the superstars who go on to become first-round picks. Over the same period of time, over the last 8 years, Duke, Kansas, Memphis, and Carolina, the only schools with more wins, and look at how many first-round NBA picks they've had.
And they've had some pros. You know, I thought Sam Young and DeJuan Blair should have been first-round picks. They were not. But they're quality pros.
They're both playing well right now for their respective teams in the NBA as the foul goes against Lamar Patterson of Pittsburgh. And we check it again with Aaron.
Well, Dan and Jay, as you guys know, a big storyline heading into this game, playing at the Pavilion, intimate setting, 6,500. Villanova's won 46 straight here. I got to tell you, Jay, you were here this morning. I don't know if you guys tired them out early, but, I mean, it's very, very calm. Now, the students only get 1,500 of the tickets, so maybe that's a reason why. But compared to what we saw this morning, Jay, I got to say it's not very hostile in here.
Not yet, but, you know, people are fickle. They like to see the ball go through the basket.
And we haven't seen a whole lot of that tonight. We had a 3.5-minute stretch recently where neither team scored a single point. You can see Villanova has won 46 in a row at the Pavilion. Their seniors have never lost here. They're 41-0 in their careers in this building. And you've got to imagine that is a huge source of pride for the likes of Fisher and Pena. Now, to be fair, generally speaking, they take the bigger games, if you will, downtown. But they've still played a lot of quality opposition over the years in this building, too.
No question. I talked with Steve Lapis, former Villanova coach, yesterday, and he was saying he always thought they should have played more here because they win.
Brown shovels it off, and J.J. Moore can't convert.
And it was contested.
Now an errant pass and numbers for Nova. Pena, Waynes. Fisher the follow. That's getting a little hostile.
Well, Jay Wright asking for a foul when Villanova went to the basket, but Corey Fisher not giving up on the play. That was not the prettiest fast break. In fact, I saw Pena double dribble there, but he did a good job when he got down toward the basket of not charging.
And it's given to Villanova a three-point lead with 5:30 here to go in the first half. The effort is outweighing the style point so far in this one, would you say?
No question. Both teams going after it and going after it hard.
Reflecting the intensity of their coaches. Rivalry Week continues Monday night on ESPN2 with two great women's college basketball games. First at 7 Eastern, catch Maya Moore, the defending national champions from UConn, taking on 11th-ranked Oklahoma. Then at 9 Eastern, Brittany Griner and number one Baylor against Texas A&M. Rivalry Week presented by Cisco. Dan Shulman, Jay Billis, Aaron Andrews. Saturday primetime presented by DirecTV from the Pavilion. The on-campus home court of Villanova.
Back to the 2-3 zone.
A great entry feed by Robinson. And the stick back good for McGee.
And McGee does such a nice job of wedging his body down low and getting position. He basically blocks out on the offensive glass.
Jay, as you look at the Big East right now, Notre Dame won again today. Louisville's had a great year. Syracuse struggling. Are there 5, 6, 7 teams who could win the Big East tournament?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. We've seen year after year some of the best teams lose early on in that tournament.
Brown, a terrific athlete, too strong off the glass, and the rebound to Cheek.
Just not finishing plays. Pittsburgh has had some opportunities at the rim, and they have been unable to finish.
Is there a dark horse team you're keeping an eye on over the next few weeks in this week?
I think Notre Dame's got that dark horse team. They're older, they can shoot it, they're very, very skilled, and they can play at different speeds.
You've made Diggers so happy. Inside, Yarou! Boy, the big man picking up the ball right off the court, laying it in.
And had to finish through contact. McGee stuck his body right into him, kept his arms up, and you can commit mayhem with your body as long as you keep those hands up. And McGee did just that.
See if Wanamaker can get going. He had the first 6 points of the game for Pittsburgh, has been quiet since. Behind the back, he loses it. Sheik cradles and blocked by Wanamaker. Waynes there and he misses the follow. What a missed opportunity for the Wildcats.
What a turnaround this could be.
And Robinson fouled at the other end. Boy, end to end they go. They're not putting the ball in the basket a whole lot, but they are certainly giving it their all. Both teams at both ends of the court here at the Pavilion.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Villanova.
Hey, Billis, Aaron Andrews back with you. Saturday primetime presented by DirecTV. Villanova and Pittsburgh, a low-scoring affair. And Jay, both teams have to have a pretty good case of lamenting the ones that got away so far tonight.
Yeah, it's been a first half of missed opportunities, and Villanova missed an opportunity after that last turnover. They did a good job of playing defense on Wanamaker on the drive. He turns it over, and Dominique Cheek's got to get this to the rim faster. He tried to get his steps down and go up pretty. He had two guys behind him. I'm not always in favor of a drop-off behind you, but you've got to go up strong and get that on the backboard as quickly as you can. He tried to avoid the shot block instead of going right into the contact and at least getting fouled. That should have been at worst a foul, and that's something that Dominique Cheek will learn as he gets older. He's a fine young prospect, but he needed to go stronger in a Big East game to get to the free throw line and finish a play.
Nasir Robinson, a junior out of Chester, PA, at the line for Pitt. This is the first meeting of the regular season between these two. They will conclude the regular season at the Peterson Event Center in Pittsburgh in early March. And nobody would be surprised if they wind up playing each other at some point in New York City at the Big East Championship as well.
And Nasir Robinson showing his versatility not only in the offensive end, now he's guarding Antonio Pena.
Pena, good patience.
He can shoot that ball. He's open.
Finally does. He knocks it down. Somehow kept his pivot foot, didn't travel, and got rid of it before a three-second call.
He was open right away off that curl move. Kind of a shooter's option play, almost a floppy set that they use in the NBA.
Wilbert Brown, terrific athlete. Pena trying to stay with him. Wanamaker behind the back, dumps it down to Robinson. And it's good.
Good pass, but an even better catch by Nasir Robinson. Having another solid ball game. He was terrific. Not good, terrific at West Virginia.
He tore his meniscus early in the season. He missed 3-4 weeks after surgery, but has come back eventually good as new and a real matchup problem for opposing teams. Yaru. Little jump hook. Nicely done.
I wasn't getting double covered. And just got into the middle. And a nice little jump hook. You can't let a guy get the ball that deep on you.
Both teams starting to pick up the pace offensively now after some long droughts earlier in the game.
Man-to-man for Villanova. They've been switching back between man-to-man. It's been containment. Hasn't been a denial man. It's been a containment man.
Wanamaker scored the first three baskets of the game for Pittsburgh. Hasn't been heard from since. LaRue ripped down the rebound. Wayne's looking to penetrate.
There's Nasir Robinson again.
Great hustle play by Robinson.
He does it at both ends of the floor. Guards every possession. He's not a shooter, not a big scorer. But he's a good passer, very versatile, and very skilled.
You know, on every team, there are a couple of guys, when you talk to a coach about a specific player, their eyes light up just a little bit more. And they talk about that player a little bit more enthusiastically. And Nasir Robinson is one of those guys when you talk to Jamie Dixon.
He's one of those guys that's low maintenance. He just helps you win and does whatever it takes to win. Jamie Dixon's got a whole roster of those guys. He doesn't have a whole lot of complainers on this team. Guys that come to work, wear a hard hat to work and like each other and get along. And they play hard. They not only play hard, they play hard together, which is not easy to accomplish.
That's why they've won more Big East games than any other school in the league since Jamie Dixon became head coach. Coming up next on the UPS Halftime Report, Reese Davis, Hubert Davis, and Digger Phelps. A breakdown of the first half tonight. The Buckeyes suffer their first defeat. Another loss for Syracuse, this time losing at Louisville. Yaruz had a good first half, getting bumped by Dante Taylor. And a foul.
And Taylor just bumped him with his chest. And you know, that's really hard to officiate there, because the offensive man oftentimes is dislodging the defense. You go, wait a minute, is that an offensive foul? And you try to keep him out from getting that deep post position, then you get called for a defensive foul. That's really difficult to officiate that.
So if you're coaching a young big man, how do you advise him to defend on that kind of play?
Well, I think what Taylor did, he kept his hands up, which is what you should do. He just led with his chest there. And you can't make that contact to knock the offensive player back. But boy, you better be prepared to absorb that contact and not let the offensive man get into the middle, get into the lane.
Taylor sits down and McGee is back. Patterson is back for Moore as well. And it's the largest lead of the game right now for Villanova.
Villanova putting on some token pressure, now dropping back into the 2-3 zone. They've given a lot of different looks. Nothing consistent for Pittsburgh to go against. See, Robinson's a guy that can make a play in the middle of his zone.
He was the guy that did it in that Syracuse game. Made some great plays from the foul line.
And there it was, that extra pass.
And Patterson misses the jumper. Wait a minute. Ryan Kersey says, my bad, Villanova ball. Now, he's just doing that to get a cheer. He's just, no, I got it. Okay, we'll give it to the home team. He got it right.
Well, Robinson, when he got the ball in the middle of that zone and kicked it out to Gilbert Brown, that was a terrific extra pass to get a wide open shot in the corner. It's just Pittsburgh's not knocking down these open opportunities. And Yeru is staying down low. It's 4-on-1, and they're playing through him.
McGee on him now. The cut of his armwood. Still plenty of time.
That's an automatic cut, and they often follow a first cutter with a second cutter.
The hedge by McGee. 3 to shoot. Pena. Wanamaker the rebound for Pitt into the final minute of a low-scoring, physical first half.
Now they can take one shot here. There's a 3 or 4 second differential. All that means is you can take the shot clock down to next to zero, and then you'll still have time enough for a tip-in offensive rebound without giving Villanova the chance to take it the other way.
Into the hands of Wanamaker. Villanova, by the way, playing the last half of this half without Fisher after the two fouls. And taking the lead in spite of that. Wave off the basket. The basket does not count. The foul, I think, is on Armwood.
That's his second personal foul.
Second on Armwood.
The best offense that Pittsburgh has had in this first half has been a missed shot. They've gotten a couple offensive rebound opportunities, but Pittsburgh has not been able to put that ball through the hoop. That's the one area where Nasir Robinson struggles a little bit. The Biggie's play shooting under 60% from the free throw line.
Armwood out, go back in the second coming for Robinson. 6 seconds on the clock.
Plenty of time for Villanova to take it the other way. And you got to look for Waynes to get the ball and speed dribble up the floor.
Here he goes. Trying to go all the way. Turnaround, no good at the end of the half. Which comes to a close with Villanova overcoming an early 5-point deficit and taking a 4-point lead into the break in spite of the fact they played 10 minutes without Corey Fisher, who had a couple of fouls. Aaron Andrews is with Jay Wright.
All right, Dan, thanks so much. We've only allowed Pittsburgh to score 23 points. I know they've missed some open shots, but defensively, what else do you like your guys have done?
We've played bigger, and our length has helped. I'm just happy to survive the half without Corey Fisher. He's our heart and soul, and he was in foul trouble. We made it through the half.
I see you've been stressing hustling and diving. What's another important thing you want to see here in the second half?
Well, it's the biggies. You got to play harder. You got to play harder than your opponent. We have great respect for Pitt. Play hard. But you got to play harder. It's pretty simple.
You want harder than that?
I want harder than this half.
All right. Thanks. We'll see you.
Aaron, thank you. 4-point lead for Villanova. Halftime of ESPN Saturday Primetime presented by DirecTV. Coming up next, the UPS Halftime Report with Reese Davis, Hubert Davis, and Digger Phelps.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Cisco. Together, we are the human network. And Lexus, this is the hard way. This is the pursuit of perfection. To the UPS Halftime Report.
Antonio Pena in the first half had 7 points. It was a tough physical battle. Villanova with a 27-23 lead on Pittsburgh. Glad to have you with us on the UPS Halftime Report here at the Pavilion on the campus at Villanova. They're honoring Randy Foy, who had his jersey retired earlier this morning on College Game Day. Reese Davis, Hubert Davis, and Digger Phelps here. We see Randy sort of over the edge, right over our shoulders here, is one of the great cornerstones of the Jay Wright class that lifted this program to the next level. Really, Digger, this has been a tough game. Pittsburgh, without Ashton Gibbs, having trouble scoring from the perimeter.
Yeah, they really are. You know, both teams are 1-for-11 shooting threes, but when you look at points in the paint and 7 offensive rebounds for 7 points, that's good for Nova to keep that under control. They're plus floor. But on the other side of it, Villanova, I look at Malik Waynes. In the loss to Rutgers the other night, he's 0-for-6. Tonight in the first half, he's 1-for-7. They need him to get his game going, Villanova, if they're going to get anything going. But when you look at what, I want to give the ball inside to Gary McGee
and get him points in the paint more. And I don't think they're doing a good job of looking inside, because once you establish points in the paint, it takes the pressure off the perimeter game. Then you get better shots.
Well, for Villanova, Mukhtar Yaru has played great on both ends of the floor, and I wish they would give their big guys the ball a little bit more. Antonio Payne is a guy that can knock down that 10, 15-foot jump shot. They need to give those guys the ball more on the offensive end. And defensively, I really like Villanova's zone. Remember, they don't have Ashton Gibbs. They have not hit a three. Pittsburgh has not. Stay in that 2-3 zone and make Pittsburgh beat you from the outside, Reese.
How about this? In 60 minutes of basketball, the game against West Virginia, first half here tonight, Pittsburgh has hit 1 3-pointer. This is a team that shoots it very well in terms of percentage with Gibbs in the lineup. Second half not too far away. Had one undefeated team in 27-23 lead for Villanova against Pittsburgh. Just about set to start the second half. Now, Pittsburgh's had a little trouble establishing anything offensively. What do you want to see different from them, Digger?
Well, I think they put more pressure on the ball. They only got 2 points off of 5 Villanova turnovers. I didn't think they put enough pressure on the ball or the passing lane. The other thing is, Woodall and Brown combined 2 for 9 that first half. They've got to find their range, Hubert, if they're going to have any opportunity to get some points, because Villanova now, Corey Fisher takes his game over in the second half for Nova.
For Pittsburgh, continue to attack the offensive boards, but here in the second half, they're going to have to knock down a perimeter jump shot. West Virginia only had 1-3 from Trayvon Woodall, 0-for-5 from three-point range. Somebody has to step up and knock down a perimeter jump shot.
And, you know, the one thing, too, Villanova has held its own. They've got 4 offensive rebounds, and Pittsburgh, it leads the nation in rebound margin, but right now they're only out-rebounding Villanova by 1.
I'm looking now to see if in the second half they do what Ben Hansborough did to McGee. Run the ball screen for Corey Fisher at the high post and let Fisher take this game over.
And Nasir Robinson's had some good moments in the first half. Gary McGee is the guy that they'll be looking to in the second half. Corey Fisher back on the floor. You heard Jay Wright right before halftime say they were just happy to make it through without their leader. And, of course, Corey Stokes on the bench with an injury. Fisher, 2 fouls. He'll be back in the second half. 4-point lead for Nova. Second half with Dan and Jay coming up.
This halftime report is delivered by UPS. Let UPS put the power of logistics to work for you.
Welcome back to the Pavilion, and welcome back to Saturday Primetime, presented by DirecTV, all a part of Rivalry Week, presented by Cisco. And yes, this is a heated rivalry of the Big East. Villanova, Pittsburgh, a 4-point game in a first half that can best be described as...
Well, a lot of times we would say not a work of art, but if it were a work of art, it would have been abstract.
Nobody could put the ball in the basket, but they played really hard, and that's what you expect from these two teams. Jay Wright talked about it. Jamie Dixon, you said, whoever works harder, whoever's tougher is going to win this game.
Absolutely, and I think for Pittsburgh, both teams played well defensively. Got to give credit to their defenses, but I think for Pittsburgh, they need to move the ball a little bit more. Only had 4 assists on their 9 field goals in that first half. The quality of shot that they're getting has to improve, and that'll improve their offensive rebound opportunities as well. They need to get better shots.
And Jay Wright made the point in his interview with Aaron Andrews at the end of the first half. He just feels relieved to get out of the first half with Corey Fisher on the bench for the last 2 minutes in foul trouble. Yet Villanova not only weathered the storm, they actually took the lead with Corey Fisher on the bench, and now he's got his guard back out there to start the second half.
Well, Fisher played 12 minutes in that first half, went 3 of 4 from the field.
Wilbert Brown, and the rebound to Armwood. Malik Waynes did some very important things in the first half. A lot of different things for Villanova to keep them in the lead with Fisher on the bench.
Well, Villanova did a good job of getting the ball inside. And you think they're going to see a little bit more ball screen action in the second half. Move some of the Pittsburgh bigs around. See if you can put them into help and make them rotate.
But some mismatches after some switches here. Fisher pulls up the 3. And Yaru's been very active on the glass tonight.
Well, he's coming from different positions. He's not just locked down underneath, and that's one of the values of moving around, moving your big guys around, and moving Gary McGee around.
We saw Chandler Parsons do that for Florida last week, getting rebounds when he started off the play 25 feet away from the basket.
Well, he's really stuck his nose in there and rebounded. That's the second time in this possession I think Malik Waynes has walked. They caught him the second time.
Let's check in with Aaron Andrews.
Well, Jay Wright mentioned there at halftime that he wants to see his team play harder. Jamie Dixon said he's quite happy with how physical his Panthers are playing. But Jay mentioned first half not a work of art. Pretty basic if you talk to Coach Dixon. What he told me, we need to score and rebound. There you have it. Those were his words.
The team that scores the most points will win the game. And there is Nasir Robinson. He might have been the best player on the floor in the first half for Pittsburgh.
Well, Pittsburgh does a nice job of keeping guys along the baseline behind the defense. And in that short corner, kind of hiding back there, and they find him. Yeah, Jamie Dixon, you know, Aaron's right. Jamie Dixon doesn't give a whole lot away. Kind of plays a little close to the vest. And he has a very detailed game plan, but he's not going to tell you what it is.
You can't argue with the results. They have been remarkable going back to Ben Howland's last couple of years, and then Jamie Dixon now in his eighth season as head coach. Wayne's the three.
Those two find each other, don't they? Corey Fisher had Gary McGee switched out on him. Instead of forcing something, he was able to pass cross court and find Malik Wayne, who was ready to shoot when the ball arrived.
Again, if you weren't with us earlier, no Ashton Gibbs for Pittsburgh, no Corey Stokes for Villanova, both out with injuries tonight. Armwood wraps up the rebound, and McGee called for the foul.
You get a rebound, you have to chin it. That is elbows out, ball under your chin, or you're subject to getting tied out or tied up or the ball stripped out. It was really smart play here by Corey Fisher. Never panicked, again, stayed low. And he and Malik Wayne play so low and play the game low to high. They are awfully difficult to contain.
Fisher averaging better than 16 points and 5 assists per game. A very good assist to turnover ratio as well. This is truly one of the best guards in the Big East Conference. And that's saying something because there are so many of them.
Over 1,500 points, over 400 assists for his career. That is stellar.
Pena. And this Yaru misses the opportunity for the slam.
On the penetration, Yaru was on the baseline. That's Villanova does a lot of the same things. They hide Yaru on that baseline, a little short corner. And the penetration, he's behind the defense. And when Gary McGee helps up and helps uphill, that is going to allow Yaru. That's one you got to finish. He hit the front end of that rim. He was up more than high enough to knock that through. He's got to finish that play.
Wanamaker using a screen, long on the three, another rebound for Yaru.
Going to have to repaint the rims.
7 rebounds now for Yaru. Both teams really struggling to score. One team shooting 38%, one 31%, as Wanamaker will raise that 31% a little bit with a slam. And Pena is injured behind the play, holding that left ankle.
And Brad Wanamaker just sitting right on that handoff, and when Pena dribbled in there, he just took that ball right away from him. See, Wanamaker just reaches right in. Ooh. Yeah, he just rolled that ankle over. You're not going to be able to grab a loose ball when you're in that kind of pain.
Timeout on the floor. Pena injured. Villanova's lead down to 3. Top of the shoe off the left foot of Antonio Pena. Now wrapping it up as tightly as they can in tape. But I'm sure you did that 100 times in your career. He rolled that thing pretty badly.
He rolled it pretty good. And yeah. This is the best time to play on it now, though. The next day gets a lot worse.
Look who's in the crowd. Philadelphia Philly slugger Ryan Howard getting ready. Boy, he's got to be heading down to Clearwater any day now. Huh? Pretty good form. Pretty good follow through on that jump shot.
Always looks good when there's not a ball in your hand. Just like my baseball swing looks pretty good when there's not a 95-mile-an-hour fastball whipping by me.
How about that pitching staff the Phillies have put together for this year? Ryan Howard and company are going to have a lot of fun.
I see Corey Fisher just goes right into that contact. He probably should have drawn a foul right away, but he never gives up and keeps going at it.
How about this? You're a baseball fan. Halliday, they get Cliff Lee back, Cole Hamels, and Roy Oswalt. 4 aces.
Pray for rain.
Well, nothing rhymes with Oswalt. But we didn't think of that. Fisher, nice look. Yaru has it. Stripped, or was he fouled? And now,
oh, Isaiah Armwood, yeah, looked like he tossed aside Nasir Robinson. This could be a monitor situation.
I think Armwood's intent, maybe I'm giving him the benefit of the doubt, was to get Yaru out of there before Yaru got too upset.
That may be absolutely true, but Well, in these clashes now, you got to be really careful. Ooh.
You know what? I still want to give him the benefit of the doubt that he was just trying to get Yeru out of there, but
the play was already over.
Yeah.
And everybody's slapping at the ball and all that. I'm not sure I would give him the benefit of the doubt on that. That looked like an intentional swipe.
Wow. So, I mean, if they look at that, if that's a punch, he's going to be out of the game if they rule that a punch.
Well, that's absolutely right. Yeah. They need to go over to the monitor. I don't know what the hesitation is.
Jim Bird, James Breeding, two of the officials going over there right now to have a look.
I can't imagine this is going to come out well for Isaiah Armwood.
Now, remember, Stokes is out. Pena just rolled his ankle. If they lose Armwood for the rest of the game.
Now, the play was dead. It was dead on the ball being knocked out. And that, you know, who knows what the intent is, but that did not look accidental to me. I don't know how they're going to define punch, open hand, all that stuff. In my book, that's not a punch, but it's certainly unnecessary contact. And it could very well be a technical foul.
But not an ejection, not a flagrant foul.
That would be my judgment.
Yeah.
There's just no place in the game for this. None.
Pretty good restraint by Robinson. And he did the right thing. He turned to the official right away and just made sure he was aware of what had happened.
Yeah, that just didn't look unintentional or incidental. Looked purposeful.
Now the officials have seen all the angles that you have just seen at home. And now Jim Burr and company will make their ruling. Whichever coach they go to talk to is usually the one who's going to get the bad news. Did you read Brian Kersey's lips? He's trying to tell us what's going on. I think he said technical foul.
I think he said contact technical.
Contact technical.
My lip reading skills aren't particularly good.
Which would be two shots. Okay, James Breeding's going to come over. Jay will take off his headset, and we'll get the official word. Okay, great. So it is an intentional technical foul. So these two free throws being shot by Yeru were for the personal foul that went against Pittsburgh. And then Armwood has been charged with an intentional technical foul, which is two shots and the ball.
Two shots and the ball. And that's a game changer right there.
So Yeru makes them both, and now Pittsburgh will go down to the other end to shoot two, and then they'll get the ball back. Meanwhile, Pena has checked back into the game. Jay Wright's still looking for an explanation, it looks like, from Brian Kersey right now. You think the best judgment was made in this?
I was absolutely right. Yeah. I don't see how you could reasonably view that and think it wasn't intentional. It looked like a purposeful swipe to me. And
this is Jay Wright after the judgment, and you can see how upset he is. And this is not a man who gets upset easily.
I'm not sure whether he's upset at the judgment of the officials or the lack of judgment of his player.
So Armwood's still in the game. Sorry, Jay, Pena back in the game.
Now, and Jay Wright didn't see it. Maybe if he had seen it, he'd feel differently. Antonio Pena just pushed Gary McGee in the back. And, you know, Villanova, right now, a little bit of the air has been taken out of this building. They've had a lead. They need to play smart here. And Pittsburgh has shown great restraint. But it's a lot easier to play in this atmosphere now after the air has been taken out of the building.
Early second half. Pittsburgh down by three. This would tie it. Brown misses it. And Yeru's on his way to a double-figure rebounding game.
Well, it's not like Pittsburgh hasn't had open shots. They have had open opportunities and have not been able to get them to go in.
Fisher to Pena. He's going to test out that ankle right away, elevating for the jump shot. It'll stay with the Villanova.
Now, Villanova has not been setting a lot of ball screens. They've been going with, you know, Pena down low, being able to choose whether to come off a screen on one side or the other. He's been curling off to get into the middle. But
there's one there by Yeru. Fisher tries to split the D. Nice find to Bell, but Robinson's right on him.
Oftentimes out of that out-of-bounds underneath, they're going to get it into Fisher. He gets an immediate ball screen. It's an automatic call. So you can really go into that head and get a foul. And I think Fisher's got to continue. When Gary McGee hedges out, he's got to go right into his legs. And he will get a foul call.
So Pittsburgh looking to get within one and maybe tie on this trip. Wanamaker driving on Bell, lays it in. It's a one-point game.
That's the first score that Wanamaker's gotten since very early in the game. Didn't he hit his first three shots?
Had one basket late in the first half, now with 10 points, but he did have 6 points 2 minutes into this game, and now, again, we've got a stoppage.
It's a nice curl off the Gary McGee screen up top, and Villanova trailing around it. Nobody steps in to help, and we've had a lot of committee meetings in this game.
I don't know if this is a clock issue right now.
It's turned into a football game.
Isn't this the building where they've had trouble with the shot clock sticking? The clock has stuck in this building a couple of times in recent weeks, I think, and they've had to go to the replay to see how much time should have elapsed. I'm not sure if that's the situation here, but I think they've had issues here in the last couple of weeks. And now they're going to run the clock down a little bit.
Well, college basketball is very sensitive to timing issues. They get the time exactly right, or strive to. And that was a good screen by Gary McGee up top. And Brad Wanamaker is such a versatile player.
And you can see the game clock and the shot clock, neither one of them moving as the ball was advanced. So really, we're looking at 3 seconds, 4 seconds, something like that.
Problem is, it takes 5 minutes to figure it out.
Yeah. And Jim Burr, you can see his displeasure as he slams the ball down. Better be careful, Jimmy, you don't get a tech.
Do our ratings go up when these officials watch this much television?
One more look. It ran down to 15:08, as it should have. Clock keeps running after the made basket, but now it stops. Three Mississippi. How many Mississippis did you get to?
Well, then it went to slow motion.
Right. Mississippi. this is above our pay grade, don't you think?
Very much so. I think the word I would use is excruciating.
All right, 2 seconds has come off the clock. ABC, your home for the NBA Sunday Showcase. Action gets underway tomorrow with two of the top contenders in the Eastern Conference, the Miami Heat and the Boston Celtics. And at 3:30 Eastern, it's the Lakers and the Magic. What a great doubleheader. Coverage of ABC's NBA Sunday Showcase gets underway with Buick Regal NBA Countdown at 12:30 Eastern.
So what was it, 6 seconds came off the clock?
Is that what they decided? Yeah, something like that.
We can't get those 5 minutes of our lives back.
Jay, you're just going to have to let it go. Waynes driving on his high school teammate. Boy, he had a nice idea, but the pass a little behind Armwood.
Villanova likes to do that a lot. When the penetration comes from one side, a guy from the opposite side will make his way across the lane and get that diagonal pass. It was Armwood there, just couldn't corral it.
Wanamaker can't shake Waynes despite a couple of screens. Now leans in, draws the foul, and banks it home.
Boy, how smart a play was that. Terrific shot fake, and then going right into the contact. Lost his balance a little bit. Little step back. That's a terrific move by Brad Wanamaker. Looks like he slipped there, able to turn the corner, and that step back or step aside just got Waynes to bite on it, and it goes right into him.
And again, Jay, high school teammates Brad Wanamaker and Malik Waynes here with Roman Catholic High in Philadelphia. Wanamaker 2 years ahead of Waynes. Waynes will have to sit down.
And that Armwood intentional foul turned out to be a really big play.
It has sparked a 7-0 run for Pitt that has given them the lead. So there's the play you were talking about.
Yeah, he just goes right into his leg. Yeah. He's going to draw that foul just about every time. You know, if you stop there and try to go around it, you're not going to get that call. You need to go. Fisher's really smart. He goes right into it. He'll pick up that call almost every time. And now if they use Dante Taylor in that, he just go right into Dante Taylor.
Fisher driving this time. They play on, and it goes in somehow.
The smallest guy in that pack and still finishes that play with contact.
9 on the night now for Fisher, and we're back to a tie. Woodall, a high arcing three from the corner.
That looked like a little 2-3 zone going back. What a terrific shot by Woodall. Finally, Pittsburgh sees something go through the net. That was their first three.
And his buddy Ashton Gibbs up and cheering. The injured Ashton Gibbs up and cheering on the bench. You know, Pitt only made 1-3 in their win at West Virginia earlier this week, and Woodall made that one. Dania too strong.
In that game against West Virginia, they dominated the glass. They haven't been able to dominate the glass in this one.
Wanamaker fortunate to maintain possession. Robinson wrapped up and fouled. He'll shoot a couple.
A terrific pass by Wanamaker and a great extra pass. When we say extra pass, it's really the right pass by Woodall to get it down to Robinson on the baseline.
Pena picks up the foul, his third. Pitt leading by 3 on the road here at Villanova.
Throw with your Sports Center right now. No more undefeateds in college basketball. 24-0. Ohio State, number one in the land, went to Wisconsin, blew a 15-point lead, and lose 71-67. Badgers undefeated at home. In the Big East, Syracuse has now lost 6 out of 8. They came back from 20 down, but Louisville still gets them in the end. The Cardinals win it 73-69. Sports Center follows our game, guys.
All right, Ryan, thank you. So the top 10 will have a new look to it when the new poll comes out on Monday. Number one, Ohio State, you would figure, is going to drop a couple of spots, usually the way it works. And this game, Pittsburgh and Villanova, will have an impact on the top 10 as well. Another team starting to knock on the door right now to move into the top 10. Duke with a game tomorrow night at Miami. Connecticut will host Providence tomorrow. Those Mountain West teams, San Diego State, BYU, how good do you think they are?
I think they're very good. San Diego State has a group of men. They rebound the ball very well. Kawhi Leonard would be a star in any league. They don't shoot the ball, the Aztecs, they don't shoot the ball particularly well. They're not a great shooting team or a great offensive team. But there's not anybody out there they cannot beat. I think it'll be interesting if they win out, if they were to win out, I think they'd make a great case for a number one seed, because the top four teams in that poll that we just saw, they're going to absorb some more losses. I mean, I know Ohio State was the last team that had a goose egg on the right-hand column, but I didn't think for one second that anybody would go undefeated this year. Not for one second.
Did you think for one second that a 6'2 guard would have 41 points, 20 rebounds, and 9 assists today? Norris Cole at Cleveland State against Youngstown State, I believe it was. 41 points, 20 rebounds, and 9 assists. That's a good month.
The 41 didn't surprise me because Norris Cole is a big-time player. He's averaging over 20 points and 5 assists, one of only 4 players in the country that's doing that this year. The 20 rebounds floors you. He had a double-double in each half.
And the great graphic, in the past 15 years, 2 players have had 40-20 games in Division I, Norris Cole and Blake Griffin.
If he can dunk like Blake Griffin.
Well, Randy Foy, who's here tonight, he knows a thing or two about that. He's a teammate of Blake Griffin's, as Woodall bangs at home.
There's got to be times, if you're playing with Blake Griffin, when he does something, you've got to just start laughing at how ridiculously athletic he is.
The crowd trying to rally the Wildcats, and the turning point, Jay, right around that technical foul that Armwood got. Pittsburgh has gone on a big run ever since. Robinson. Wow. and is fouled. Two Wildcats are on the deck, and Robinson will be going back to the free throw line.
He got grabbed. That's one thing. There were a lot of extra steps there. But you're right, Pittsburgh, that Armwood intentional foul during the dead ball was the turning point in this game. And this pace has been Pittsburgh's pace.
His last foul is on Corey Fisher, his third. Robinson's already into double figures with 10 points. The average is just over 8 a game.
And you can't say enough about the play of Nasir Robinson. He's been terrific over this recent stretch, especially the last couple of games.
And here's the play Jay was talking about. If you missed it earlier, Isaiah Armwood. And I guess only he knows right now, was it intentional or accidental, but a punch to the face, maybe punches a little bit strong, to the face of Nasir Robinson was called for an intentional technical foul, two shots in the ball. And it's been all Pittsburgh ever since. She pulls up and gets the bounce.
So that was nice. The ball screen, throwback, and then attacking the closeout.
And don't you like to see a guy not go too far, too deep into the defense? Just
exactly.
Pull up.
Yep.
Smart play by Trayvon Woodall and
also by Jamie Dixon to call that timeout. Otherwise, it would have been a lost possession.
Now we're sitting here just outside of Philadelphia, a little bit northwest of the city on the campus of Villanova University. But when you think Philadelphia basketball, one of the first guys you think about is Wilt Chamberlain, a legend from Overbrook High School in Philly. He won four MVP awards, two NBA championships. Dr. J, an 11-time All-Star, and this was a team, Jay, playing when you were playing at Duke, the 1985 national champion at Villanova Wildcats. Rolly Massimino, the head coach, the so-called perfect game against Georgetown to win the championship in 1985. And there's such a proud tradition for so many of these institutions.
Well, LaSalle trying to pick themselves back up under John Giannini. St. Joseph's fallen on a little bit of hard times under Phil Martelli lately, but that's been a very proud program, and he's done a great job there. And, you know, Fran Dunphy is one of the best coaches that doesn't get credit because he doesn't look for it. That's one of over 400 games. He's terrific at Temple.
First at Penn, now at Temple. Long rebound, bounces free to Fisher. One-on-one with a Wanamaker, steps around him. Too strong. Armwood, got it. Oh, we have a foul before the basket. A foul on the floor.
If you bring that ball down, Pittsburgh slaps at it. You got to be really strong with the ball.
Timeout on the floor. The Wildcats trying to claw their way back into it.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Cisco. Together, we are the human network.
But time now for tonight's game track brought to you by Cisco. Pittsburgh has taken the lead here in the second half of the strength of a 15-4 run that pretty much coincided with a technical foul on Villanova's Isaiah Armwood. Brad Wanamaker hot early, then disappeared for a while, but he still got 13 points. The highest score in the game, Nasir Robinson with a dozen. Corey Fisher leading Nova with 9.
I'm not sure Corey Fisher has enough shots. He's taken 7 for the ballgame at 4 in the first half, only 1 of 3 in the second half. And he needs to be more aggressive in looking for his offense. That'll open up things for teammates.
And Mutai Yaru, forgive me, actually has 10 points, so he's the high scorer for Villanova. He's got 8 rebounds as well. Sheep for 3. Missing badly, and Wanamaker lets it bounce out of bounds to Pitt.
Well, Villanova has done what they've wanted on the glass. They have hung with Pittsburgh on the backboard. That is not an easy thing to do. Not many teams can do it. They are not scoring efficiently on their offensive end.
And they've been hurt by their turnovers. Pittsburgh has 14 points off 10 Villanova turnovers tonight as Wanamaker calmly knocks down another mid-range jumper.
Brad Wanamaker plays with great pace. I said it before, I think he's the best player on this team. Ashton Gibbs, the best scorer by far, but I think he's the best player.
Trying to get around the screen from Yaru. Pena to Armwood. Sheik again. Long rebound to Fisher.
Nice job by Robinson to knock that ball away from behind.
And a 20-second timeout. Corey Fisher calls it as he was down to the court with the basketball. 10:25 to go in the second half, and the Pittsburgh lead just gradually is getting bigger and bigger as the fourth-ranked Panthers try to do something nobody's done in 4 years, and that's win in this building, the Pavilion, the on-campus home of the Villanova Wildcats. And if they get the win, Jay, Brad Wanamaker is going to be a big reason why.
Well, Brad Wanamaker is one of the most versatile players in the country. He's a playmaker. Gets into the teeth of the defense and able to make a play. They're going behind his back, shedding a defender, and calmly pulling up for a jump shot. And then getting into the middle, getting around a shot blocker in Yeru and finishing a play. And smart enough to draw a foul and finish a play out on the perimeter. Wanamaker has everything in his game and never forces anything. Like we said before, he's unflappable. And he's gone over 1,000 points in his career. But he does everything. He's got rebounds, assists, steals.
Better than 5 rebounds per game. Better than 5 assists per game. Better than 12 points per game.
What Pittsburgh has done, they've capitalized on mistakes. They're 10 turnovers for Villanova in this ballgame, and Pittsburgh has capitalized on those.
Waynes, tough jumper over Wanamaker, who stuck with them. McGee the tap, Yeru the tap. Loose ball back to Villanova with a fresh 35.
Well, that is quick on quick. He just shot right past Wanamaker, and it wasn't like Wanamaker was standing still.
Where does Villanova find offense?
This is the guy that has to get going, but they've got to set some ball screens for him, let him blast off that, try to find something.
Here comes Yeru to set one. Fisher around McGee, dumps it down. Yeru contested by McGee. And it'll be pick ball.
That's a play Yeru has got to finish. I thought actually Fisher was going to shoot that ball, but he gave it up to the big guy, and he didn't go up right away. First of all, that's a foul. McGee does a good job of hedging out, but
that might have been a foul too.
Yeah, he's not in legal guarding position there. He's got to call that.
Brown off to Robinson. Good decision there. Now, Pittsburgh's going to play you tough and physical night in and night out. Jay Wright knows that as well as anybody. As he said to Aaron Andrews at the end of the half, if his team wants to win the game, they've got to play harder than they've been playing. And there's a hard foul by Yeru on Robinson. Maybe a little frustration coming out for Muftau Yeru.
And the first guy up was Nasir Robinson. Went up strong, and Yeru making sure that he's not going to score there and have to earn it from the free throw line, where he is not a great free throw shooter. Robinson along that baseline. He's found some openings down there, either in the middle or on the baseline.
It's easy to develop respect for Nasir Robinson in a hurry when you watch him play basketball.
He plays a tough game. Doesn't make mistakes. He's one of those guys that doesn't need the ball to play. But he'll go get it for you. You don't have to call a play for him. Low maintenance winner.
Misses both free throws. McGee to the deck. But it's Villanova ball. Bell came up with it, I think. Now Pitt's got it back.
Bad play by Chief.
Wow, Gary McGee. Largest lead of the game for Pittsburgh.
Now that's how you finish. Well, poor play by Cheek, and I'm not sure this shot was what they wanted either. Just took it too quickly without making Pittsburgh guard. Now Villanova going to have to spend 25, 30 seconds on defense.
Jay, it's now a 19-4 run for Pittsburgh.
And it was ever since that intentional technical foul by Armwood. That changed the whole tenor of this game.
Brown, a deep three, and the rebound to Fisher. Here he comes with Waynes, 2-on-2. Corey Fisher wrapped up by Wanamaker. The crowd wants an intentional foul, but they're not going to get it.
Well, they should have gotten it. I don't know how you can wrap a guy up like that and not get it.
Timeout on the floor. One more look going to break. 2 free throws for Corey Fisher. When we come back, maybe this will give Villanova a bit of a spark and help him get back into it. A new fire.
exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by DirecTV. Don't just watch TV, DirecTV. And in part by Cadillac, the new standard of the world.
And welcome back to Villanova University. Dan Shulman, Jay Billis, Aaron Andrews. Saturday primetime presented by DirecTV. A 10-point lead for Pittsburgh. Corey Fisher will be going to the line for two momentarily. But after the play, double technical fouls. Keep an eye on Nasir Robinson first. 35 in blue coming in right there. You can see him talk to Fisher. Fisher responds in kind. The two of them yapping back and forth. Technicals assessed to both players, and the significance is no free throws, but the significance is a technical counts as a personal in the college game. And for Corey Fisher, Jay, that's his fourth foul.
And not a smart play by either player. And I didn't see the exchange. I mean, I was watching that pileup. You couldn't really see it, and the officials obviously were right there and could hear it. But there was a difference between the foul that was given up by Villanova by Yeru on the other end, which you might be able to argue it was a really hard foul. Maybe you could make an argument that it was excessive, but he didn't wrap the guy up, hit him hard with his body. But that one by Wanamaker, he just grabbed him. And that was not a tackle, but I mean, he wrapped him up. And by definition, that's an intentional foul that wasn't called.
And now Jay Wright takes Fisher out. Four fouls, 7:55 to go, down nine. We'll see how long he leaves him there, or if he starts right away, Jay, kind of subbing it in and out offense defense when the opportunity arises.
Well, I don't think he can leave him out very long because Pittsburgh has just dropped the hammer on Villanova. They've just been tougher since that Armwood technical. Pittsburgh has been much tougher.
Villanova has scored 10 points in the second half. Pittsburgh's got 23.
Pittsburgh's stronger with the ball. They're getting the ball into the lane, which is exactly what Villanova wanted to stop. And they've been able to get it on the baseline. They're finishing plays.
Both teams over the limit as Robinson knocks down the front end. He is 7 for 11 at the free throw line tonight. He's been very active, and he's been rewarded with a lot of trips to the line.
Well, as loud as this building was this morning for College Game Day, you couldn't have imagined it would be this quiet this evening. And that's a beautiful sound to a road team, is a quiet home crowd. That means you're doing your job and doing it well.
6,500 here at the Pavilion. That's capacity. 1,500 of them are students. Bell, tough spin-around shot. Good offensive rebound and the putback.
Well, Bell is going to be a good player. Big, strong, athletic. Got his own rebound. And now this crowd trying to get into it a little bit.
It's only an 8-point game. Feels like more than that. Wanamaker the miss. Robinson misses on the follow. And Yaru is called for the foul.
Well, you can see the aggressiveness on the glass by Pittsburgh. And that aggressiveness rewarded. And that was a gang offensive rebound. They send four guys to the offensive glass. That puts a lot of pressure on your blockouts, on your defensive rebounding, especially on your guards. Because guards aren't always used to blocking out. They'll get down and get in the lane and wait for a longer rebound, but they're not used to physical contact and boxing.
And Robinson again knocks down the first. Robinson's going to have some bumps and bruises after this game as the Natalie attired Ashton Gibbs looks on from the pit bench, nursing a sore knee.
You know, it's funny, when a leading scorer goes out, you often hear coaches say, hey, somebody's got to step up. Somebody's got to do more. And that's the opposite of what Jamie Dixon says. He says, nobody has to step up. Nobody has to do more. We just have to play our game. Some guys are going to play more minutes, but we have to play our way.
And even a situation like playing in this building, a very difficult place to play. Jamie Dixon gave the same answer. They just have to do what they do. And they've done it tonight, especially here in the second half.
Well, they're not going to make excuses and say, well, you know, tough place. They play in tough places. This is what they do. That's going to be the way they approach it. And they're not going to make a big deal out of everything. They're just going to play. And they're going to play hard. They're going to play their way. And it has worked to the tune of 10 or more Big East victories for 10 straight years. That's the longest active streak in the league.
They've won more Big East conference games than any other school in the league since Jamie Dixon took over. They've been to Sweet 16s. They've been to one Elite Eight. And they were a Scotty Reynolds driving layup away from getting to the Final Four 2 years ago. That's kind of the last step for this program to take is for this group to get to a Final Four.
Now, is Scotty Reynolds considered kind of the Bucky Dent of Pittsburgh? Is that the way they look at it?
I think you might be right. It was a great game in the Elite Eight a couple of years ago between these two programs, who, of course, knew each other so well from their Big East battles. And just think of the Pittsburgh teams, and Jay, you've done more of their games than I have over the years, but you go back over the last 10 years, Troutman and Lett and Zavascus and Jerron Brown and Brandon Knight. I mean, every single one of them just tough as nails.
Tough individually, but much tougher collectively with the way they play. Now the crowd trying to get in a little bit, and there you can see the strength. The two high school teammates from Roman Catholic, Malik Leans from Villanova, and Brad Wanamaker of Pittsburgh. Wanamaker is so strong and such a terrific handle. He would rather go left and coming off that ball screen using that left hand. He's tough to contain.
10th team foul on Villanova. Two shots the rest of the way for Pitt. The next Pittsburgh foul will be the 10th on them. And Wanamaker, 71% from the line, knocks down the first as Cheek comes in for Armwood. And again, Fisher remains on the bench right now with four fouls for Jay Wright. Getting ready to check back in.
10-point game, as you mentioned just a minute ago. There's still plenty of time. 6:15 to go in regulation. That's a lot of time. Not a lot of time if you keep missing opportunities. And Villanova's got to start taking advantage of some of these opportunities.
Well, they just look out of sync offensively right now. It's a lot of dribbling by Waynes, and nothing's happening. They're not advancing.
And against a team that lets you make passes out on the perimeter, it's been a lot of dribbling the leather off the ball.
Pena. Brown and Yaru battling for the ball. And on the possession arrow, it'll stay with the Villanova.
Yaru's done a really nice job on the glass. This is not an easy team. Pittsburgh rebound against. He has been really strong on both ends on the glass.
And here comes Fisher now in for Sutton.
Fisher's a veteran, and you can't worry about picking up that fifth foul. You got to be smart. You also have to be aggressive.
Got a tough, rangy, athletic defender on him in Gilbert Brown. Waynes a deep three. Yaru tries to tip it out, but Robinson has it for Pitt.
Great hands by Nasir Robinson. He gets the ball in those mitts. He's keeping it.
Well, the two teams, Jay, are a combined 3 for 21 from three-point range.
Big East rock fight.
Brown, nice look. Taylor. And he's fouled by Yaru. That will be the fourth on a move to Yaru. Big Monday presented by Bud Light, a part of Rivalry Week presented by Cisco, is on ESPN, the home court of college hoops. It begins at 7 Eastern to West Virginia, taking on Syracuse, and then at 9 Eastern to Kansas and Kansas State. K-State will look for a little revenge after that lopsided loss against the Jayhawks a couple of weeks back. Rivalry Week presented by Cisco. Jay, another Big East question for you. Right now, how many Big East teams get in? Is it 11?
It's in that neighborhood. I think they're going to get at least 10. Now, there's a long way to go, obviously, before we get to Selection Sunday, but I think it benefits the Big East that the Pac-10 is not as strong as it has been over the years. It's a little bit stronger than it was last year, and the Pac-10 isn't going to just get two teams like it did last year. The SEC West has not been overly strong. I think the ACC has not been to the level of excellence we have come to expect, and I think the Big East is going to be a beneficiary of that.
Well, St. John's right now is sitting 10th in the Big East standings, but they've got an unbelievable number of quality wins that other teams are drooling over. Let's take a look at the top 12 of the Big East. And so many ranked teams, of course, but you're looking at teams like Cincinnati, Marquette, St. John's. These teams are having good seasons.
They are, and they've got, as you were saying, quality wins, as does Syracuse. And, there's 68 teams going to be in that field. I think we're looking at a pretty soft bubble. So if you've got some quality wins that you can point to, everybody on the bubble has proven one thing. They've proven they can lose. And the teams that have proven that they can beat quality opponents, even if it's only three of quality wins that they've had, that's going to go a long way to getting you in the field. And if you get into the field this year, you've got a chance.
SportsCenter is next here on ESPN. Pittsburgh with a 10-point lead on Villanova. Less than 5 minutes to play here at the Pavilion, where the Wildcats' 46-game winning streak in this building is in jeopardy. And Corey Fisher just fouled out of the game.
Well, that's a tough call for Corey Fisher. Brad Wanamaker did a nice job of moving his feet.
The fifth personal foul for Villanova is Corey Fisher.
I don't know. He did a nice job of moving his feet. You got to give that young man a lot of credit. But that's the toughest call in basketball right there. And solid defense by Brad Wanamaker.
And a frustrating night for Corey Fisher. Remember, Stokes is injured. So now Villanova, in addition to needing a lot of stops, where do they get the offense from? They have been so in so much trouble here in the second half trying to score. They've only got 15 points in the second half.
Well, it's got to be first Malik Waynes. He's a guy that can go off the dribble, good shooter. He has not shot the ball well in this ballgame. But they're going to have to get something going defensively.
And they get a turnover. Gilbert Brown throws it away.
And Jamie Dixon doesn't want his team to harp on one mistake. Don't turn one mistake into two. I'm just talking about move on to the next play. Get back and defend.
That's the first turnover this half committed by Pitt. Waynes inside. Lost it, but it bounced off a Pittsburgh defender out of bounds. Villanova keeps it.
When he got into the middle, he was looking to make a play with the pass. I think he could have gone straight up with that and gotten a relatively easy floater.
Waynes has quiet 7 points tonight.
Well, pretty much everybody for Villanova has been quiet on the offensive end.
They're shooting 32%. In the game. That'll go up a little bit as Waynes knocks one down. It's an 8-point game. And here comes the pressure again. And here comes the crowd again. And they got it back.
Jamie Dixon saying that the ball was kicked before it went off of Gilbert Brown.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Villanova
cheerleader. He's not going to win the argument. A back-to-back turnover is committed by Pittsburgh. Villanova gets one basket, and they've got the ball back here in this slugfest as they look to get back into the game. It'll have to be Malik Waynes to try to lead the Wildcats back. Battling for a spot in the Final Four, Villanova won the game on the drive by Scotty Reynolds, wound up losing to North Carolina in the national semifinals. And a lot of the Pittsburgh guys on this team now were on that team then, including Brad Wanamaker, Gary McGee, and you know they'd love to, even though this is a regular season game, they'd love to get one back against Pittsburgh. And ultimately, of course, this group of Panthers, they want to get over the hump and get to their first Final Four.
Nice dutch in by Yeru.
Good entry feed from Pena.
There's not enough pressure on Antonio Pena out front to discourage that pass on the duck end.
And a 10-point deficit is down to 6 after a couple of made baskets.
Well, Brown picked the ball up just over half court and invited a trap. Very fortunate to get out of that. Nice.
Robinson lost it on the way up. It just seemed to slip off his fingertips.
It came off a little back screen, had a wide open opportunity. Really well run by Pittsburgh.
Robinson does a nice job moving without the basketball.
Sure does. They lifted the Villanova defense and took advantage of it on that back pick and cut. And Villanova just couldn't corral the rebound. Armwood had it.
There's some confusion for Villanova. Who's supposed to come out of the game? Jay Wright's got something to say to Jim Burr. I don't know if Bell is shaken up and if it's Bell that Wright wants out of the game or not. Maybe checking for blood, but it appears to be okay. He'll go back in. The freshman getting some crunch time minutes. You got to believe Pittsburgh will use some clock, execute. Well, check that. Another turnover for a team that went about 15 minutes this half without a single turnover. They've now turned it over 3 times in about the last minute and a half.
Well, Gilbert Brown coming off that double screen when he caught the ball, absorbed a little bump, and just stepped on the line.
Corey Stokes injured. Corey Fisher's fouled out. Malik Wayans.
Malik Wayans, so tough off the dribble. And this is what he does. Look how he splits that. And even though there's contact, he is able, look how he keeps his eyes up on the rim. His eyes never leave the rim. Absorbs that contact without worrying about it, without looking down, and without taking his eyes off the prize. That was a big time play.
The foul on Nasir Robinson, his second. And it's an 8-0 run in the last minute and 53 seconds.
And all of a sudden, we've got a one possession game. Matching up in a 2-3 zone. This is where Nasir Robinson can operate in the middle.
Wanamaker, big shot.
How nice was that? Taking a little ball screen. Nobody stepped in. Talk about absorbing contact. Here comes the ball screen, and Malik Wayans has got to be there. He's got to get his body right where it says Big East and discourage that drive. If there's a pass out, you've got to make Wanamaker give up that ball. If there's a pass out, then you recover.
What a night he's had, looking so confident at the line. 20 points now for Wanamaker, and the lead is back to 6.
We talked about him being the best player on this Pittsburgh team. He's proven it tonight. Yeah, McGee denying Giroux that low post position. He's going to get a foul. That's quite a wrestling match down there.
Giroux at 6'10", 250. McGee 6'11", 250. Number 4 on Gary McGee. Jamie Dixon right now is going to send Dante Taylor, the sophomore, into the game.
Drew hasn't missed a free throw tonight.
And a very good free throw shooting team, over 77% as a team on the season. And year after year, they're one of the top teams in the NCAA in shooting free throws. Well, look at Wisconsin, 83% as a team. One of two. Sutton in for Giroux. So both big guys, Giroux and McGee, just went to the bench.
And Pittsburgh strong with the ball. You know that Villanova's going to try to slap that and take it away. You can't pick your dribble up.
Wanamaker. And he'll go back to the free throw line.
And that's what I'm saying. If you're strong with the ball and absorb the contact, you're going to go to the free throw line. And this is where knocking free throws down on the road can get you a big W.
Well, Wanamaker just so calm and confident looking out there.
Yeah, nothing bothers him.
Yeah.
He's a young man that was recruited both by Pittsburgh and Villanova. A lot of these players recruited by both schools.
Giroux back in. Temple was also very big in the recruitment of Wanamaker. He almost went there.
He wasn't a highly rated player, but he can do so many things. He's going to help you win. He's really helped this Pittsburgh program win.
A game high 21. Wayans thought about the three, and a foul call. Boy, that was going to be a dunk at the other end had that call not been made. Jamie Dixon not agreeing with the call, but Wayans is going to get a couple of free throws.
Well, the Pittsburgh bench, when that call was made, everybody in a suit danced around like you can't believe over there.
Pittsburgh has not lost on the road this season. Both losses at home, one to Tennessee, one to Notre Dame. And again, Villanova's got a 46-game winning streak in this building. There's not a single Villanova player on the roster who has ever lost in this building. Well, they're going to have to make something happen. One, knocking down free throws. They've missed a couple in their last two trips. But they're also going to have to make something happen defensively. A deflection, a steal, a big rebound. Got Brown trapped, and he gets out of it. A triple team over there in the corner. And you can't pick your dribble up just past half court. Gotta believe Wanamaker's going to get a touch. Here he is, off to Brown. Under 2 minutes to go.
Running the continuity, just a back screen, down screen continuity.
And Armwood comes over for the block. Wanamaker's shaken up. Bell! And an air ball on the three. And now a held ball. It will be Pittsburgh ball, and Wanamaker still in some discomfort.
I'm not sure Bell should have shot that. Not just because he missed it, but that wasn't the shot. Momentum is with you after making a big defensive play on the other end. And that's where you get it to Waynes and let him make that decision.
There's the block when Wanamaker was shaken up. Block definitely clean up top.
Yeah, Sutton clipped him after the block.
Yep. And Pittsburgh is going to use the timeout. Rivalry Week continues Monday night on ESPN2 with two great women's college basketball games at 7 Eastern. Catch Maya Moore and defending national champion UConn as they host number 12 Oklahoma, or number 11 Oklahoma, excuse me. Then at 9 Eastern, it'll be Texas A&M against Brittany Griner and number 1 Baylor. Rivalry Week presented by Cisco, and there will be ISO cameras on ESPN3.com. on Maya Moore in the first game and on Brittany Griner in the second game. So you can watch the game on TV, and then on your computer you can have a camera devoted just to these two great players, Maya Moore in the first game, Brittany Griner in the second game.
Well, Maya Moore is as complete a college basketball player as I've seen. I think Diana Taurasi would be right above her just a bit, but I've never seen anything in the women's game like Brittany Griner.
6'8", right?
6'8". Dunks with two hands. A lot.
And as somebody who's 6'8", you say that with a little bit of envy. You didn't dunk quite
it's
as much as
envy,
you did.
It's, just, it's flat out jealousy.
A minute and a half to go. Pittsburgh with the ball and a 5-point lead.
Pittsburgh can afford to burn the clock and get into a set.
Woodall with the shot clock at 6. Penetration and a foul. Well, you can't do it much better than that. They ran 33 seconds off the clock and then got a drive to the rim.
Well, a really nice hesitation move by Woodall, and you can see just how quick he is and quick with the ball.
And it's the fifth foul on James Bell. So the freshman from Orlando is done for the night. Well, these are the kinds of games that the Pittsburgh basketball program really takes pride in. They don't want to outflash you. They want to outwork you. They want to out-tough you. And they're doing that here tonight. They're winning in Pittsburgh fashion tonight.
No question. And doing it without Ashton Gibbs, their leading scorer, a guy who's the best three-point shooter in the Big East. He shoots about 48% from three and was knocking him down with regularity, one of the best catch-and-shoot players in the country. So they haven't changed the way they play. They've just played stronger and tougher. And take a look at Gibbs right there. For them to go on the road and win at West Virginia and then have a great chance here with a minute 8 to go and a 5-point lead, a couple of free throws, to win in a place where nobody's won in 46 straight games. You know, we're talking about program wins. Now, this isn't just a good team. It's a terrific program.
And a win tonight would keep Pittsburgh a game and a half ahead of Notre Dame. Notre Dame won at South Florida earlier today. Notre Dame beat Pittsburgh earlier this season, but the two teams do not meet again during the regular season.
Ashton Gibbs sitting over there saying, "Look, guys, you could struggle a little. am I not that valuable? Come on."
They need it, and they get it. Pena for three. His second three-pointer of the season.
Pena is a good shooter, a very good face-up shooter. When he catches that ball, he caught it ready to shoot. Now, Robinson was there with a hand up. He certainly didn't want to foul. But the little handoff and the quick pass. And his shot preparation was terrific. But now with 58 seconds left in regulation, a one-possession game, Villanova doesn't have to foul here. They can go for a steal and play it straight. And if they get the ball, take it to the rim. Pena is a good shooter. A very good face-up shooter. And when he catches that ball, he caught it ready to shoot. Now, Robinson was there with a hand up. He certainly didn't want to foul. But the little handoff and the quick pass. And his shot preparation was terrific. But now with 58 seconds left in regulation, a one-possession game, Villanova doesn't have to foul here. They can go for a steal and play it straight. And if they get the ball, take it to the rim. To try to extend the game.
The Panthers are on top in the Big East Conference right now at 10-1 in the league. They haven't won in this building since 1994. Villanova trying to extend a 46-game winning streak here at their on-campus, their cozy on-campus home that seats 6,500, almost all of whom are standing right now.
Well, without Ashton Gibbs, or without a great free throw shooter, Gibbs are shooting 96% in Big East games.
Well, Wanamaker just so poised.
They didn't panic. Maurice Sutton just lifted up and let him get by.
Shot clock at 7. Wanamaker stripped from behind.
Don't need a 3 here. Waynes needs to get this ball into the lane.
Which he does. Saves it. 15 seconds. Shot clock turned off. And Jay Wright wisely calling a timeout as that possession was starting to slip away. That's the last timeout for Villanova.
And Jay Wright asking for a foul on that spin. He felt that Malik Waynes got fouled. I didn't see it.
Well, Jay, now that it's down to 12 and a half seconds, do they need the 3 or can they still go for the quick 2?
Yeah, you don't have to have it. If you can get right to the rim and get that quick 2, you can take it. The problem is if it's Malik Waynes going to the rim, now you'd want Waynes to be taking that 3, and he can't do both. Now, so there's not a lot of perimeter options to knock down a shot.
And Corey Stokes is hurt. Corey Fisher has fouled out. Pena just knocked one down. Dominic Cheek, if he's in the game, is a possibility. He's 35% from beyond the arc. But you're right. Their two best options are not in the game right now.
You know, we've talked about how tough Pittsburgh has been, and they have been extraordinarily tough without Ashton Gibbs. But Villanova's been awfully tough to put themselves in a position now to tie this ball game. And you know, Jay Wright's been holding this together with duct tape and baling wire, and they've got a chance here. Now, one thing, if it takes a while to get into this action. If he can get it down to around 5 seconds or under, you know, Pittsburgh, it would not be bad strategy to foul. Now, I don't think they're going to do that. That has not been Jamie Dixon's style. But it certainly wouldn't be a bad idea if you can get the right clock situation. I think under 5, when you're up 3, is the only time you foul. More than that, and you're extending the game and giving Villanova a chance.
Sutton, Armwood, Pena, Cheek, Waynes. Waynes with a basketball. 8 seconds to go. Cheek gets it off. Waynes
didn't get it off.
It will not count.
Get it off.
Yeah. It is immediately waved off by Jim Burr.
Now they have to look at it.
Yeah. But even Jay Wright knows it's not going to count. He's already shaking hands with the Pittsburgh coaching staff, and they will look at the monitor. But as you said, Jay, right away with a live eye, they did not get it off in time.
Well, they have to make a call. And they made that call, and Jim Burr waved it off. Now, if it shows that they have to go back to the replay by rule. So it's kicked out, and it looked like it was still in his hands. He'd have to slow it down. But that looked like it was still in his hands live, and certainly looked like it there. Yeah.
Yeah. So Pittsburgh hangs on to win as they beat Villanova 57-54. to go to 11-1 of the Big East, and Villanova falls a little bit closer to the bloated middle of the Big East right now as they drop to 7-5, and the Wildcats' 46-game winning streak in this building is over right now. Pittsburgh remaining a game and a half ahead of the Irish on top of the Big East standings. Aaron Andrews is with Jamie Dixon.
Dan, thanks so much. Coach, I want to ask you first about the run that your team made after the techno foul to Armwood. What propelled that run there?
I felt real good at halftime. I think I told you that coming out. We missed open shots. We were executing pretty well. I felt good about where we were at. And so second half, we just came out and played. And it really didn't surprise us. We played good in the first half, didn't make shots. Second half, eventually, we did.
Let me ask you about something that probably won't surprise you. Brad Wanamaker's poise.
Yeah.
What do you think about that when you watch? I mean, you know the environment in this building when you watch him on the sideline.
I think our Philly guys played like Philly guys is what they did tonight. Brad Wanamaker, Nasir. It was good for them to come back home and play like Philly guys. So proud of them. Not surprised, but very proud of them.
Thanks so much for your time.
Thanks.
All right, Dan.
Aaron, thank you. Those two Philly guys, Wanamaker and Robinson, combined for 36 of Pittsburgh's 57 points as Pitt beats Villanova 57-54 tonight here at the Pavilion. Coming up next here on ESPN, it is SportsCenter. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. Along with Jay Billis, Aaron Andrews, and our entire ESPN crew, I'm Dan Schulman saying thanks for watching and so long from Villanova, where Pittsburgh beats the Wildcats. SportsCenter coming up next.